Hi, everyone, and welcome to A Conversation with Laini Taylor and Megan Whalen Turner at the North Texas Teen Book Festival. I'm Mandy Aguilar, and I'll be your moderator today. I'm a librarian at Irving Public Library in Irving, Texas, and I also serve on the NTTBF Steering Committee. To all of you watching, thank you for joining us for our first virtual festival. It does feel a bit strange to be broadcasting from my spare bedroom instead of in person at the convention center, but I know that we're going to have an amazing time nonetheless. Before we start, I want to remind all of you that our NTTBF swag shop is open on the website, and you can also purchase the books that you hear about today on our site too, powered by bookshop.org. And all of that being said, I would now like to welcome our two amazing authors who are here to talk about their much beloved book series that are having some important anniversaries. Laini Taylor's Daughter of Smoke and Bone trilogy is 10 years old, and Megan Whalen Turner's Queen's Thief series is 25. Laini and Megan, please say hi to our viewers. Tell us a little bit about these books and tell us how it feels to reach these milestones.
Okay, great. I'm gonna make Laini go first.
Okay, no fair.
and Laini's not gonna tell you about her books, but she's agreed to tell you about my books. And then I'm gonna tell you a little bit about Laini's books.
Yeah, so I'm not sure when I first discovered Megan Whalen Turner's The Thief. It wasn't 25 years ago, so I didn't read it. I wasn't a child 25 years ago, but I didn't have that experience of reading it as a young reader. I think that I read it first when I was really beginning to explore literature for young people as a writer, as a genre that I wanted to write in. And it's just, it blew me away. It is one of those rare books that, I know, Megan, we should have talked before.
I know. I'm completely tongue-tied talking about your books, too.
Without doing the thing. But, I mean, Megan is revered in the writing community as someone who is as much of a sneaky trickster as her main character, Eugenides, Jen, who is one of the best characters in fiction. The thief, the eponymous thief. These stories now span six books and made a very complete and incredibly politically intriguing storyline set in a world similar to ancient Greece, but not totally. And they are just incredibly crafted. So you never see what's going on in front of your face, even when you're looking for it. And your mind is guaranteed to be blown over and over, and they're just intensely gripping. I saved Return of the Thief, the new book. It came out in the fall, but I saved it until recently because I had a bunch of deadlines going on, and I couldn't put it down. I mean, it's the same experience always whenever I read Megan's books, but I picked it up and just immediately was like, it was glued to my face. And as soon as I finished it, I went back and reread the entire series back to back, which I hadn't done because the books came out over a space of time. I think I might've read the first three all together at one time, but then they were sporadic, and just getting that entire narrative in one dose and seeing how they all fit together was an incredible reading experience. And I'm just constantly in awe of Megan. And I think I'm talking more about my experience with the books than the books themselves, but they are the story of the thief Eugenides and these three nation states and their struggles against a larger empire that wants to consume them. And there is romance and so much intrigue, and they are just fascinating. And if you haven't had the pleasure yet, you are in for a huge treat. And to be able to just go through them all at once, rather than having to wait for the next book. So get on that.
Okay, so I regret to say that I only have Daughter of Smoke and Bone on Kindle because I couldn't find my hard copy. So I can't really hold up my phone with
here's the new box set.
Oh, great. Because when I read them, they look like this. And one of the things I've really enjoyed is watching the covers change over the years as different people interpret your characters. But Daughter of Smoke and Bone is initially set in Prague in the wintertime. And there's a 17-year-old girl who is just what you expect from an art student in a city like Prague. She's got blue hair and she's got little tattoos, one on one hand and one on the other, that say true and story. And she has a million sketchbooks filled with these really elaborate drawings of these monsters, creatures. They're sort of part human and part animal. And so there's a serpent woman who's a woman from the waist up and a snake from the head down. And there's a enormous man, and I am going to get this wrong, Laini, but I always think of them as ram's horns. That brimstone has ram's horns. The people at the art school think that Laini has Laini does have a really active imagination. That this character, Karu, has this really active imagination, that she has imagined all of these creatures. But what they don't know is that this is her family. These are the people that have raised her in an environment that's not really in our world, but is accessed by multiple doors all over our world. They all can lead into this liminal space where Karu has grown up, and she spent her whole life trying to balance the fact that she has a normal life outside. And she has this other secret life where she runs errands for the Chimera, these people who are part human, part creature. And I can tell when I'm getting really excited because I'm waving my hands in front of me. Okay. So one of the errands that she runs is really creepy. She collects teeth because Brimstone, this character, needs teeth for some reason, and she doesn't know the reason, and she's a little bit disturbed by the whole process, but she loves these people. They're her family. And then I love this about the book, Laini, this very claustrophobic start in a dark wintry Prague sort of mushrooms out into not just an enormous world, but a whole universe, because there is another world on the other side of that liminal space. And in that liminal space, there's a war between the people Karu loves and people who look a lot like angels and are not nearly as friendly. And it's a wonderful story, and it's exciting, and it's like nothing I'd ever read before. It's incredibly original, and there's a just heart-stopping romance in it. And I'm not usually a fan of heart-stopping romance books. But wow, it is over the top, and it is just wonderful, every word of it. And there's three books: The Daughter of Smoke and Bone, The Days of Blood and Starlight, and then The Dreams of Gods and Monsters. Although then you maybe move into some further books that may or may not be connected.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, thank
you. So those are the books, and you all can just, you know, go read them now.
Yes. Thank you for that description. So Megan, you had a book come out pretty recently. What was it like to write, you know, wrap up a saga that you've been working on for so long?
It, on the one hand, it was really wonderful. And on the other hand, it was just more than a little bit surreal. Thanks to the fact that I've been thinking about this obviously for about 25 years. And to finally come to this point in reality that I had been imagining over and over and over and over again for 25 years. There was something a little bit anticlimactic about that, but also there was this huge pandemic, and the whole world and the whole year was so strange. It's hard to know whether my feelings are caused by the fact that I've finally come to the end of this series or by the fact that, you know, the whole world is burning down.
Right.
Yeah. But one thing that's been really great is seeing everybody finish this final book. It didn't really seem real until people were reading it and people were responding to it.
What have you heard from people?
Well, the other thing about this book that's a little different from, well, actually I was going to say from my previous books, but it's been 25 years. It's like every single book has been published into a very different environment. Mm-hmm. So there was a while back in the day when you had galleys and only librarians got them. And then there were galleys and everybody could get an advanced reading copy. And then there was a time when everybody started getting the galleys and, you know, spreading them a little bit too widely. And as a result, now there were no galleys. There were no advanced reading copies for Return of the Thief. So I didn't have any idea how people were going to respond until the book was published and people started reading it. And one of the great things about that was the very first reviews I got were from longtime readers. Instead of getting, you know, the random guy from Kirkus or Voya or, you know, I mean, I know who's going to be reading it at the Hornbook. Hi, Jonathan. but no, the very first reviews I got were from all of the people that I have been interacting with online for, you know, 10 years now, and to have them come in and say they were happy made me so happy, deeply relieved and so happy. Yeah. So that was great. That was really awesome. And also because the promotions were all online, as this is online, I mean, I really miss seeing everybody in person, but the one upside to this is that people from all over the world came to the book launch. So that was awesome.
Yeah, it's been really interesting this year. I mean, I think no matter what happens with our book touring in the future, we have to keep these online events because, you know, no matter how much touring we do, we're not going to get to a fraction of the places where we'd like to meet our readers. And this is just amazing. It's not as much fun, but it's so much more available to people.
Yeah, to think that somebody in the Philippines can type a message into the chat.
Yeah.
And hear an answer in real time is just mind blowing. Yeah. So sorry, do you want to ask me another question? Because I have a question for you.
I do. I want to ask you another question. So I read somewhere that you said that you don't consider a book a success if the reader only reads it once. And I wanted to say, first of all, Megan, what hubris. Most of us are happy if the reader will just read our book. But on the other hand, like, there aren't that many books that really demand a second reading, and yours do. And that's part of what I love about them so much, that they conceal so much, even when it's right under your nose. It's so amazing. And I would love to know, in a quick 1 minute answer, how do you do that? And can you teach me? No, I mean, really, the kind of plots that you do aren't, you know, you don't see them very often. And the kind of thing that when you do reread it, you see all the clues, and it's as rewarding in a different way on the second, without being surprised, but seeing the way it was done is a completely different kind of experience and just as much fun as reading it for the first time. And that's really rare. And so I wonder how you construct those.
I don't say
it's easy and it just comes out that way.
you've either got it or you don't, Laini. Sorry.
It's effort. These are your first drafts, right? This is just how
exactly. The first draft, Laini, takes 7 years to write. And it's 7 effortless years. So I don't feel like it's hubris.
I'm totally teasing you.
I feel like I just set that bar really highly because I love a book that you enjoy rereading. You know, when I was my whole life, I have read and reread and re-reread. I mean, I've read Daughter of Smoke and Bone like 6 times in the 10 years since it was published because every time I read it, I see something a little bit different, or I am just reading it for comfort because I just love to immerse myself in that world and forget everything all around me. And so what I wanted to do when I was writing was give the reader that option.
Yeah.
And what that means is I don't expect them to get it all on the first time through. And, you know, sometimes when you have a big twist in a story, the author has gone into this with the idea that you're supposed to guess it. Like, they put all the clues there, and why haven't you figured out who done it by the time the big reveal when the detective says it was Marjorie, you know? But that's not how I write the book. My idea is that you have all of the information in front of you, but you don't have the key.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the book, I want to give you the key, and I want it to retroactively change the meaning of everything that you've just seen. So
exactly what it does.
There's not an expectation that the reader guesses it.
Right.
But that means that when you read it a second time, you have a different book to read.
Yeah.
Because now everything is different from the way it was when you first read it. And while it's great to have no spoilers and not to have the book spoiled, I also really wanted to make sure that if it ever is spoiled, or if you do actually just guess whatever's going to happen in any of my books, I want it to still be enjoyable. I don't want it to be like a one-trick pony where the only thing that's enjoyable about the book is the surprise at the end. And then, well, you put it back in the library book drop and you go read something else. And sorry, this is taking a lot longer. But I wanted to say about how you do it is mostly I use conventions against people. We have really strong conventions in our writing, and we have to have those strong conventions because otherwise we would never be able to shorthand anything. Every book would be 1,100 pages long. So we have these writing conventions. For instance, one of the conventions is that if you have a first person narrator, they will wake up in the morning and cast their thoughts back to their entire life. Like, whoever wakes up in the morning and reflects upon their entire life before they get out of bed and then stands in front of the mirror and describes themselves to themselves, you know? But that's exactly what happens in the beginning of almost every first person book that you will read, is there's some excuse to reflect over the history of the character, and somebody's got to look in a window or a mirror or a puddle so you know what the main character looks like. and so I went with a first person character, and then I just didn't follow the convention.
Yeah. I mean, that is really the case with Ferris in this new book. I mean, you know, you definitely have so little context with this character starting out and what he looks like, and the way the clues slowly come together, but never completely, to give you an idea of who this new narrator in book six, this new unknown character is. It's a really interesting way to do. Well, and another thing that you do that is uncommon is to shift from book to book between first and third person narration. And I love that you just do whatever serves the story best. And I'm curious, you know, how you make all these decisions, and if you agonize about it at all, or if it's just very clear to you, you know.
No, I never agonized. Remember, it was effortless. It's all effortless.
No.
I really prefer third person books. I like to read in third person. I would like to write in third person.
Really?
It's really frustrating to me when I sit down and it all comes out in first person. So I wrote all of Thick as Thieves in third person, and then it didn't work. And I had to throw that whole draft away and restart in first person because it, as you said, you have to serve the story, and the story needed to be in first person. But now I have a question for you, Laini.
Okay.
I want to talk to you about the ends of your books, or as I like to say, Laini, why do you do this to me? Okay. Like I said, I have read Daughter of Smoke and Bone six times, And it is such an immersive experience that every single time I come to the end of the book and go, wait, what? And it's why I now have both the hardcover of the second book and the Kindle, because I couldn't wait to find where I have misplaced the hardcover. And I went and I bought the Kindle. Laini, why do you do this to me?
Well, I did it to myself too, is the thing, because I knew that way that book ended, but I didn't know what I was going to do next.
You're kidding me. When you published that book, did you not know?
I did not know. I mean, I knew in a general sense, you know, what I wanted to happen, but I didn't know how I was going to make it happen. You know, I knew I wanted, so something very shattering happens at the end of book one, and I wanted to in some way heal that. And I didn't know how I was going to do that. And I didn't know how many books it was going to take. I didn't even know when I was writing Days of Blood and Starlight, if there was going to be a third book. I try to know these things. I really try. Like, I'm not like a comfortable.
You're not tormenting me on purpose is what you're saying.
No, oh God. I mean, if I could sit down and know all these things up front and outline everything, like, I would be the happiest person. I try. And I generally know, you know, I compare it to like swimming from buoy to buoy. Like, I have to have somewhere I'm aiming for, that I know that when I get there, I can hang on to it long enough to catch my breath and not drown, sort of thing. But I don't know like how to get there. And so after I wrote the end of Daughter of Smoke and Bone, and I knew it was the right ending and I knew where I wanted to get to with these characters, but you know, I had created a profound breach between two characters and I didn't know how I would ever, I was like, you know, writing Days of Light and Starlight going, I just want them to kiss again, but I've done something so unforgivable that I don't know if they ever would. And so I just, you know, how the story creates its own logic as you go, and you do things and the characters react to it, and you try to understand in your head, like, what is the real thing they would do? Or, you know, what would really happen here? And it's like this, you know, sort of slow conversation between you and the book as you make something happen, or something happens, and then you come to understand what the characters would really do, and then you take it to the next step and hope that you can gently corral it in a direction you want it to go. And sometimes you can, and sometimes it never feels like that thing it is natural, that thing you hoped would happen. You realize you can't make that happen, but in this case I did find a way to make things happen the way I wanted, you know, but it took a while and they had to go through a lot. And I, you know, I had to honor the situation that I had set up. And so I think, you know, I've heard people talk about that writing is lying for a living. And I've always felt like that feels completely wrong to me. I feel like what we're doing isn't lying. It's we're creating a truth. And it is a truth that only exists like in our head and on paper, but it has to feel like the only thing that could happen. It has to feel absolutely like this is what really happens here. It isn't a lie, it's the truth of that story. And so that's what I'm always trying to find and hope that it's what I want to happen too, but it isn't always, and you know, it can surprise me. But that's why I think if I knew everything and if everything was effortless, that it would feel sort of flat. But that's like slim consolation when I'm trying to figure out the plot, you know?
So do you ever get into the second book and think that chapter 4 of the first book was a terrible mistake and you should have done it differently?
I luckily haven't had that like, oh, damn it, if I could only go back and change this, not in any profound way. But I have had, and I wonder if you've had the experience, where something that you did early on, just because, or maybe for texture or whatever, ended up being hugely resonant later on. And you're like, high five yourself as if you know?
Yes, exactly, right.
Yeah,
right.
I love it when that happens. And luckily, knock on wood, I haven't had like a huge dope like moment. Though, you know, I think there is something to be said, like if one could write a trilogy before publishing book one, but like, that's just not the reality of our world for most of us.
I don't really understand how you can do this without giving yourself ulcers. I am a person whose book, every book has a beginning and a middle and an end. And if I got run over by the bus after Queen of Atolia, it would be fine. Fine.
No, it wouldn't. It would not.
And I hope that a person starts with the thief and goes all the way through Queen of Atolia, King of Atolia, Conspiracy of Kings, Thick as Thieves. And finally they get to Return to the Thief, and there's a narrative arc there. But it's so important to me that every single book stands on its own.
Yeah.
Partly because I grew up depending on libraries. And if books were a big, wonderful luxury item. You got a couple of them at Christmas. But otherwise you went to the library, and every once in a while you got to go to the library book sale and like buy the $5 bag of books. And even now I would say 80% of the books in my house are ex libris. They're all from book sales at the library. And so you never knew if you were going to have book three. Yeah. Or you didn't ever start the series because they never had book one in the library. And so I would frequently start series with the third book or the sixth book or whatever.
I mean, I have wanted, you know, actually with Strange the Dreamer, that was supposed to be a standalone, because a trilogy is, you know, it's a grueling thing. And I would definitely argue that while your books can be read, you know, standalone, it's such a richer experience to read it as a series. But, you know, of course it is, but it is cool that they can exist on their own. And, you know, when I read Thick as Thieves, it had been a long time since I had read King of Atolia. And you know, and I hadn't actually read Conspiracy of Kings at the time. So I had a hole, and yet it still was completely substantial and, you know, satisfying on its own, but it's so much better in context. So it's cool that it works as both things. But I just naturally like things just expand into these long stories that can't be contained in one book that anyone would ever want to pick up and hold. You
know? Well, that was the other thing I was going to ask is, do you ever think about like writing the doorstop? Just keep writing till you get to the end of the 1100 page book.
I mean, I definitely know I have like a resistance to that, because I wouldn't want that as a reader. Like it's intimidating to me, and I love long books, so I wouldn't want it. So I'm definitely the part of my brain that's like constantly second guessing everything, and that's so worried about the reader's experience, would never let a book get that long. Like some of my books already as they are, I feel like they're really long, and they're not any, I don't think I've written anything longer than 160,000 words, which was a lot. I can't even remember. I can't remember numbers. I have things, but they're long. But a friend of mine, Samantha Shannon, is writing a book right now that has passed 300,000 words. And she's like, when will this thing ever end? And I'm like the idea to me, and I've read one of her books that's almost that long and it's wonderful, but like to me, that's just too long for me personally. I don't want to write books that long. But that's why Strange became a duology, because it got too big for one book. The book I'm writing right now is a standalone.
and it is and should I believe you when you say that?
What?
And should I believe you when you say that?
Oh, yeah, it definitely like
totally going to be a standalone. Well, mine's going to be in third person.
Is that in question? Is it?
No, I'm sure it's going to be in third person. It's totally going to be in third person. Trust me. Yeah. Yeah.
So what are you writing now?
A lot of little pieces of everything. I'm having real trouble settling back in to a groove. And I don't know if that's just because of, you know, 25 years of working on the same thing. But I think it's just the year. Yeah. What a completely bonkers year. And I'm having trouble focusing.
Oh my God.
And instead of, yeah, right. And instead of kicking myself for not being able to focus on a big project, what I'm doing is just every day you sit down and you write something, just write something, mm-hmm. just every day. And what that means is I'm writing this on Tuesday. I'm writing something else on, I'm going to write a short story. And then I work on a short story. And
Well, I mean, there have been times in my life where I have worked like that. Like if I was waiting for, an editorial letter or something, and I loved it. I love being able to wake up and write. And have you ever read the Ray Bradbury writing book, Zen and the Art of Writing by Ray Bradbury?
No.
I love it. It's one of my favorite writing books, and it's a series of essays. And one of them, he talks about how he found his groove as a writer was, you know, after years of being very prolific as a young person, but being very, you know, copycat, like, you know, writing, copying, you know, the pulp writers that he loved and not having found his own voice yet, that he made a list of like nouns that were sort of meaningful to him, things like places or whatever. And then he would just sit down in the morning and like start just riffing on one of those words. And it would like, by the end of the day, evolve into a story. And that was how he became Ray Bradbury. That was like how he found his voice, by his, like this sort of, by sit down every day with like a free association almost and turn it into a story in the course of that day. And, you know, I love doing that too. I love writing from prompts and I love, you know, doing exercises, but when you're writing a novel, you can't really, you don't have the luxury. I mean, you can do it as an exercise in the morning, but you can't really finish a story and you have to get back to your characters and pick up the thread that you left the day before. And so the times in my life where I have had a little bit of luxury of time to play, to just write what I feel like writing that day. I mean, that's how Daughter of Smoke and Bone was born, actually, was like a day of writing something just for fun. So I love being able to do that, but then hopefully something will spark, you know, enough that you're like, can't let go of it. And
right. And I expect that that's what's going to happen, is I will eventually settle in to one thing, because what I found over the last, you know, 25 years is that once I have this story in my head, I can't really go write anything else. Several times I thought, you know, why don't I take a break and go write up some other idea? And I could never push the story that was already in my head out for long enough to let the other stories really come in and float around. I really think that having a quiet mind for a while is really important to my creative process. Yeah. I have to sit around with nothing to do.
Yeah, me too. Absolutely. It's huge for me. And, you know, I hear some authors say they like hit send on a manuscript to their editor and immediately open another document and start working on something else. And I'm like, because to me, that downtime is so critical. And after I finish a book, I definitely need a lot of space to sort of regrow my brain.
Yeah.
But, So, you know, so some of your earlier books, especially, were separated by a lot of years. What was that like, you know, sustaining a book over that kind of time? I mean, you were raising a family, you were, you know, not on the book a year schedule, which is awesome. I mean, and there aren't very many series, I think, that would have like necessarily stood up to those time gaps, but your books are just so good and your publishers were so supportive that you could. But what was it like having that time? Because I love to set something down and come back to it.
Yes.
And you don't always have that luxury in a regular publishing schedule. So what was it like
for you? Well, I consider myself extremely lucky that my first publisher was Susan Hirschman. And after I wrote The Thief, she said, take as long as you need to write the next book and I will be ready for it whenever it shows up. And I think it was about 3 years before I sent her Queen of Atolia. And she just said that again and again. And when she retired and Virginia Duncan became my editor, Virginia said the same thing. You take as long as you need to write the book you want to write, and we will be here waiting whenever you're ready. And I don't know what I would have done, because I do need to take a book and put it in a box under the bed for 6 months. And then get it back out again and then work on it more and then put it away.
Okay. Everything. So I was wondering, there would be big periods of time where you were just away from it and you would come back to it.
Yeah. Yeah. It really did need to go under the bed for a while. And then eventually I would drag it out and see it differently than I had when I put it away.
And I could do that as a matter of course, but it's, you know, I don't feel like I could do that right now, but I do feel like that would probably be best for the way that my brain works.
Well, there's a potential downside though, that you have to be wary of. My husband is a professor and he deals with PhD students. Mm-hmm. And you probably know that one of the things that happens to people is they go through the entire program to get a PhD. And in the end, they have to write a dissertation. And they don't get the degree until they have written a dissertation and it has been accepted by their program. And quite a few people get through the entire program and never finish their dissertation. And what my husband always tells people when they're starting out is every project has a lifetime. And you've got to finish the dissertation before it dies. Because at some point, this project, which was so exciting 3 years ago, has died. Yeah. And you can't revive it then.
Yeah. And no, absolutely.
Right. And so when I was working my way through all of these books, fortunately, each book was its own project, as opposed to the whole series feeling like, but once I hit, once I was working on Thick as Thieves, it suddenly became the whole project had a lifetime and I could see the end of it. And I really needed to get this book done before the project died. And so it was a little bit tense there last couple of years.
Do you feel like you had more time to work in the last few years though, that your boys are older?
A little bit. I do think I have more time, but I also think that my brain has frustratingly changed over the years. I used to be able to write in 15 minute bursts, right? You know, you run upstairs, you write for 15 minutes, you go downstairs, you carpool, you go fetch somebody, supervise homework, come upstairs, write for 30 minutes. Yeah, and now I'm like, well, I'm sorry, I needed to be quiet for an entire week. And then I start writing. And I'm sorry, you've interrupted me. And now we're resetting and it's going to take another week of being quiet before we can get, and it's super frustrating. And I think just a change over time. So don't dawdle. Don't waste your time. Write your books.
I mean, I definitely am, not on the fast track, for, you know, writers in our field. I tend to not, I'm not a book a year writer. I wish that it could be faster, but it just takes the time that it takes, but I'm always feeling late and that's, you know, not a great feeling.
No.
Yeah.
It's not a great feeling, but I think the thing that makes it possible is that your books are so wonderful for such a wide range of readers. I mean, I think that there's a very young reader who comes to Daughter of Smoke and Bone and sees a character who's so close to his or her own age. But the older you get, you don't get further away really from the character. So coming to that character as somebody who was, I don't know, 36, 46, 46 the first time I read, 46 the first time I read that, is still enjoyable for somebody who's 46 years old. And so if it takes 3 years for you to write the next book, or it takes 6 years for you to write the next book, you're writing a book that somebody's going to be able to enjoy when they're 10 years older than they were when they read the first one.
Yeah. And while one hopes that is the case, we also know that the industry supports a certain level of schedule. And you will be forgotten, and you will, I mean, not forgotten. It gets harder. Like, you know, you need to tap dance in front of people.
Well, you know,
but enough about industry stuff for right now.
I wanted to talk more about industry stuff.
Oh, okay. What do you want to talk about?
Well, I think you're right. The industry is founded on the idea that you have a hot writer. You need that writer to produce a book a year. And that especially in the YA industry, that the readers are going to grow up and they're going to be gone. So if you don't get your six books written in the time between their 12 and 18, then they'll never read the next book because they grew up and they went to college. And I don't think it needs to be that way. But I think for some people it really does. There's a sweet spot, and sometimes there are books written for kids in that sweet spot. But the other thing I wanted to say is that in the industry, they have an idea that you want to make the New York Times bestseller list. you're not a success if you don't sell a lot of books. And that's not my definition of success.
No, and also we know that there's nothing we personally can do to move that, you know, to make that happen. Like, that's up to them. That's their job. And all we can do is write the books and, you know, hope for the best as far as marketing and all of that stuff.
But did you aim, that was my question that I was leading up to. Did you aim for a New York Times bestselling sized audience right out of the box?
Well, I mean, The Daughter of Smoke and Bone is my fourth book. And a lot of people think it's my first book because they aren't familiar with the first three.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, sure. I was always aiming for that. Right. Yes. And also movie deals and also a private island. Why not?
Oh, well, I mean, I would like the private island and that sort of thing. But if you knew that you had an audience that was very, very, very much smaller, but that would love your books, would you write it for them?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, I think that this is my career. And so I've been lucky to be able to do it, you know, to have writing be support me. And if I had a much, much smaller audience, I don't know that I would, you know, have the same financial support that would enable me to do it as my first
eating
job.
Is good.
It's, I would nice still write, though. Yeah.
A roof over your write. Head. Yeah. Yeah.
But you know, it would be very different if I had to get a different job or whatever. So, you know, but I don't know. It's very nice to have hit that list for sure.
Yeah, and certainly, you know, once you hit the list, you can put it on every single book and that's a wonderful thing. But
he's aiming for number one now. Come on.
but I know myself that I feel so honored to have the readers that I do who love my book, and that if there were half as many of them, I would still want to write that book for them because it's the book that I want to write, and because I know how happy it'll make them. And I feel like the way the publishing industry is set up, with all of the emphasis on the big book that everybody reads, we all know that there are a lot of different books that just worked for us. You know, that it was the book we needed right then and we loved it, that might not have been published in an era where every book is supposed to be a blockbuster.
Yeah. But yeah. I mean,
I'd like to see us go back to being able to write smaller books.
And we're both, you know, lucky. I know I have this 10th anniversary edition out, and it had definitely become clear to me that, like, that the teenagers who had aged out, you know, that my readers who had aged out, the next generation or the next, you know, set of teen readers and young readers to come along hadn't necessarily had Daughter of Smoke and Bone in front of their eyes. And so I didn't have necessarily those readers. And so to have the book come out again was great. And, you know, your books have definitely stayed in print and stayed prominent. But it did be, you know, you do start to realize they go away, they lose their shelf space. And it's sobering to realize that, yeah, I mean, it might always exist somewhere, but it's not going to get into readers' hands in the same way over time necessarily, yes. Unless you're very, very lucky. And I don't know. So I'm really, really happy to have the new editions, I guess, is the bottom line there. And it's been not a great year. I went to the bookstore the other day, which we haven't been at very often. And there were so many beautiful new books on the shelf. And it was just, we have this amazing independent bookstore here, Powell's. It's there's, you know, it's incredible. And it was just so, there's hardly anyone in there because this year, and because Portlanders have been pretty good about obeying quarantine and whatnot. And I didn't even think to look if they had my new editions on the show. Didn't even think to look for that. But you know, to have a book out this year and know that people aren't going to be stumbling upon it by chance in person the same way that that's a bummer. And I know that your new book came out on a day that like 300 books came out or something because there's been this huge bottleneck, because in the spring all the publishers were like, whoa, let's not publish this now, let's wait because this will pass and then we'll publish it. And so then in September it was like
right. And you know, my book was originally supposed to be published in spring of 2019.
Oh, you were one of those pushes. Okay.
No, I wasn't one of the pushes. I was the person who told her publisher at the last minute that the book's just not ready.
it has to push back. I've been a person too.
Exactly. And that was miserable to have to do that. But when I see my book coming out in October of the pandemic year, I know that that's really on me, because if I turned that book in when I was supposed to be done with it, that book would have been out a whole year before this pandemic.
Oh, it was a year.
Yeah. So that's like the opposite of the high five.
Yeah. I did that with Strange, only there was luckily no pandemic, but I was late and, you know, it does affect things.
Yeah.
You know, the publishers have very specific schedules and plans and budgets and everything. And when we're late, those things get thrown off, and they do their best. But let's see.
I have almost completely lost track of time.
We are for now. We're getting close to needing to wrap up, but we either have time for maybe one more question from either of you, or I can ask one. Which do you prefer?
I get to ask.
Okay, go for it.
I'd like to know, Laini, when you're writing your books, are you thinking about your audience? What are you thinking about your audience? How do you imagine your audience when you're producing the book?
I mean, it's a good question. I think that I am operating on the hope that my audience is like me and is interested in the same things that I'm interested in and will be wowed by the things that I'm wowed by and be fascinated by the things I'm fascinated by, because that's really my only gauge. And it is a big leap of faith to assume that my weird fascinations will carry over. But that's pretty much, you know, I'm aiming for readers who are like me. Mm-hmm. And I try not to think too much about them. I think the voices that get in my head in a like an anxiety way, or, you know, maybe wondering, you know, what kind of reader am I aiming for? Is this literary enough? Is this smart enough? Is this commercial enough? Is this fast moving enough? Is it pacey enough? You know, it's like I want it to be smart and commercial and, you know, and when I start thinking about those kind of things, then it, you know, I can get stressed out. And then at a certain point, I kind of just, I look at it and I have lost all context, you know, the things that, you know, a year ago now in the writing of this, I was like, oh my gosh, this is the coolest, shiniest, weirdest idea ever. I'm like, oh, that thing, you know, and I can't remember what it felt like when this was like new and shiny and weird. So I have to just sort of have faith that it will still feel that way, hopefully, to readers. But yeah, I guess I think I just think about my readers, my sort of reader kindred spirits, people like me. How about you?
Pretty much the same thing. I really have to go. I write from the idea that I am writing a book for somebody who wants to read my book. And I'm not going to try too hard to like rope them in against their will, or, you know, have the hook on the first page so that I suck their eyeballs into the story. And no, I always just assume that my reader wants to read my book, and that, yeah, like you, my reader likes the same crazy things that I like.
Yeah.
They're happy to have descriptions of cities and ruins and strange sort of Mediterranean-esque landscape, and that they'll break for inset stories about the gods and the creation myths of this world that I've invented, that they'll stick with me through long, slower passages in order to get like the really big hit at the end of the long, slow passage that you can't get without slowing everything down first. I write from a position of great faith in my reader. And my feeling is that if they don't want to read it, that's fine. Nobody has to like my book. And I hope that they won't plow through it if they're not enjoying it, and they can go read Laini's book. So that's all good. I like the idea of a willing reader. And as you say, somebody who shares your interests, and you can assume that they share your interests and will enjoy the things that you enjoy.
Yeah. And it's cool to, you know, to know living in the world that we live in, with the ability to connect with our readers and really have this sort of window into the world, that there are so many of us, you know.
Yeah.
I can't imagine really what it would have been like to be a writer 50 years ago and not interact, you know, maybe get letters, but.
Or how about 25?
Yeah.
I'll just say really quick that when The Thief came out, there were no Amazon reviews.
Right.
There was, the only reviews you got were from, like, you know, if you were lucky, the New York Times. If you were lucky, the library and review journals, like the Center for Children's Books or the Horn Book or School Library Journal, if you were lucky, there would be a review in there. And it was always by a professional reviewer, a librarian whose job it was to tell other librarians, not readers, librarians, do you want to buy this book for your collection or not?
Now, I'm curious about your path to publication too, because I recall that I don't believe you had an agent when you sold The Thief. So did you, was it a slush pile book? Was it just a?
It was a great deal of luck. Wow. Talk about lucky. Undeserved luck. I sent two of my stories to Diana Wynne Jones, whose work I really, really admired. And she not only read them, which is blinding luck, and liked them, which is even more luck. She wrote back to me and said that I should send them to her editor, Susan Hirschman.
Oh my God, wow.
So in one sense, yes, it was an unsolicited manuscript over the transom to Green Willow, but it went with Diana's cover letter on top of it saying, Diana Wynne Jones likes these. How about you?
And that's amazing.
Yes, and that's how I came to the attention of Susan Hirschman.
Were these stories related to The Thief or unrelated?
No, and now, you know, of all the books I have behind me, I do not have my first book, which was Instead of Three Wishes. So The Thief is not my first book. It's my first novel. My first book was a collection of short stories called Instead of Three Wishes.
Yeah, I've seen that in your, listed in your bibliography, but I haven't seen that one.
Yeah, so that was the first book. And then The Thief was the first full-length novel that I wrote.
So when you and I met for the first time in person at LeakyCon, a Harry Potter fan convention in Chicago, like 10 years ago?
Yes, right.
I just remember Clementine was a baby and you were like, down on children at the time. You were like, I don't know what your kids were doing. You were like,
No, it wasn't so much down on children as I was on parenting. I still feel that we don't support parents the way we
did. Yeah, that's
but you know what?
I can't remember, but I mean, the thing that I remember that the conversation came up with a group of writers that you admitted you didn't have an agent. And then I later set you up with my agent, who is now your agent.
Yes, exactly. Shout out to Jane Putsch at IBate Management. Mm-hmm. And
so we're agent sisters. And one of these days we should do that thing that other agencies sometimes do where they do retreats and they like go to the Caribbean together and stuff. So
Right. And we know Jane is watching this. So that wasn't a hint or but I think I'd like the Mediterranean.
Yes, I would as well. I'm going to have to pick your brain about Greece. I have lately just gotten really fascinated with it and determined to move to Corfu. So let's not talk about that now.
that's going to be a discussion for another time.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. But thank you, because this was great. I had a wonderful time. And thank you very much to the people at the North Texas Teen Book Festival for setting this up, especially in consideration of what a year you guys have been having.
Yes, wow.
And thank you for managing to pull all of this together in spite of a pandemic and the thimble winter coming down on you in the last few weeks.
Yes, absolutely. And I wish we could be there with you in person.
Me too.
we miss reader faces.
We are hopeful for next year. So everybody cross fingers. I want to thank both of you. This was a delightful conversation and you made my job incredibly easy. I didn't have to do anything but sit here and soak in all of this amazing, amazing conversation and stories. So thank you so much. Thank you to all of our watchers too. Everyone who's looking at us on YouTube, we really appreciate it. please tell your friends. These videos will be up for a while, so everybody around the world has a chance to listen to this conversation like we just did. So thank you so much. Check out our
read Megan's books.
Yes. Oh. And
read Lainey's books.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. And that concludes our conversation. Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.